Chet?
Why, hello, Bradlin!
And what have you got for us today, Chet?
Apart from some painful carpal tunnel due to my outrageous self-pleasuring behind a curtain at your wife's pedicure...
Oh, Chet, you are a cad.
I like feet.
Well, who doesn't? The Pope? Coward?
Well, quite. Anyway, tonight, Bradlin, I have for you the sounds of Tommy Ledge.
Tommy Ledge. Wow, that sure does sound like fun.
And what Tommy has done, it's really quite genius, is that he's taken old songs, songs you, I, and America love, and he's added his own unique spin on them.
I met Wink Martindale once at a kosher handbag store in Portland, Oregon, and I added my own unique spin on him.
Oh, Bradlin, you really are too much.
You could almost say I was brodacious.
Bradlin, say that again, and I'll drop an anvil on you.
That's fair, that's fair.
So anyway, Tommy Ledge redefining the all-American songbook with his own versions of the classics, recorded invaluable backing vocals to songs that we all and our grandpapas love. Here, for example, is his incredible rendition of Stand By Me by Benny and the Jets.
That's Ben E. King, Chet.
Go fuck yourself, Bradlin.
When the night has come and the land is dark and the moon is the only light we'll see. No, I won't be afraid. Oh, I won't be afraid. Just as long as you stand by me. So, darling, darling, stand.
Well, wasn't that incredible? My goodness, at a lemonade stand in Little Rock, Arkansas. If that hasn't just taken that classic and improved on it tenfold, I don't know what could.
I thought it was an absolute travesty and utterly ridiculous, Chet, but then I have marmalade for brains.
You sure do, Bradlin. Not to mention breath that could melt the dress of Lady Liberty herself.
That might not be a bad thing. I've been dying to see what she's got under there.
Bradlin, you're a despicable, wretched, zucchini-breathed ox crotch, and the only thing to drown my sorrows from standing so close is Tommy Ledge and his rendition of the immortal classic that's all about one of the greatest cities on the entire planet, and dare I say, many other planets as well. New York, New York.
Spreading the news. I'm leaving today. I want to be part of it. New York, New York. These vagabond shoes are longing to stray right through the very heart of it.
Well, I don't know about you listeners, but I'm rushing out to buy this album when it's released on Wednesday. I may even buy one for my horse, my mother-in-law, and the President of these United States. It makes my bosom swell with pride.
It's not the only thing that swells with pride on Chet, I can assure you.
Why, you ignorant, un-American... Ow! Oh! Ah! Ah! Oh! Oh!
Well, while Chet and Bradlin work out their differences, it's time for the After Movie Diner, which this week comes from a pie shop in Norwich owned by a man who believes his cat is a reincarnated alien chieftain who has discovered the cure for farting by utilizing root vegetables and the music of Carly Simon.
Yes,
this, it's a new episode of the After Movie Diner, and you're either listening to this shitting a brick about the upcoming American election, despairing and not understanding how it all came to this, possibly chewing on some red rope licorice, playing nonchalantly with a handgun and sticking gooseberries up your ass with hateful abandon, or you're listening to this after the election has been called, and maybe Trump won, and you're sitting in a grey windowless bunker listening to this on low so the military police don't beat and arrest you for smiling or being poor. And this is the last episode of the show because I've either been deported, shot, or strung up in front of a courthouse with a US flag shoved in the tip hole of my old todger while overweight gentlemen sing hate-filled anthems about Jesus. Or Hillary won, and absolutely nothing has changed except some fat, red-faced, gun-toting old white men are crying, pissing their pants, and painting swastikas on Confederate flags, claiming that any day now they're going to overthrow the state and return things to how they used to be before computers, opinions, and women having the right to vote. Well, however you're listening, and wherever you're listening, and whenever you're listening, thank you. And my guest on this show is third-time largest pubic mound runner-up in the Wentworth Local Men's Club Meat Raffle and Painter Stripper Weekend, owner of some of the largest false teats in all of England, punisher of crabs, despiser of Piers Morgans, puncher of donkeys, and surprisingly doesn't care much for vinegar. He's the rootinest, tootinest doctor of action who knows several ways to skin a poodle for Jean-Claude Van Damme's handbag range and exactly where to put the detonator to make Steven Seagal's bison burgers, which consist mainly of a whole bison, just right. It's the one, the only, and thank fuck there's only one of him, Dr. Paul Crowson.
Yay! Hello.
Hello, sir, and welcome back onto the After Movie Diner. It's a pleasure to have you.
Well, it's very nice to be here.
And what films are we covering on this spankingly shiny new show?
It's drumroll, Annie Hall and Manhattan Murder Mystery.
Yes, and we're covering these two Woody Allen films because first of all, Annie Hall is one of his classics, and it's just it's sort of the proto rom-com. So we can talk a little bit about that. But also because in the original script, as my understanding was, it was much, 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 much longer. And Manhattan Murder Mystery was, in a way, rewritten out of the, like, cut scenes from the original Annie Hall. I think I'm right in saying. So it's sort of a sequel without being a sequel, but sort of a sequel.
That's correct.
And wasn't the original Annie Hall called Anhedonia? Wasn't that the original name of
it? Yeah, that's so like, it's another same for depression, isn't it? Or something.
Which is a cheery subject.
it's New York Jewish neurotic, isn't it? That's what you think of depression, which is ridiculous.
Right, exactly.
Ridiculous.
And we should probably get the elephant out of the room in terms of the whole like touching children thing. Where I just have to, yeah, dog doesn't. he did once but didn't inhale. But no, the whole thing. He's not a popular filmmaker anymore. People tend to mention him in the same breath as your Polanski or Bill Cosby or whatever. Those people. And the only thing I will say about it is, first of all, to some extent, unless someone is actually a charged pedophile, like the guy who made
Jeepers Creepers.
Where'd you get those peepers? unless you're an actual convicted pedophile like that guy, I don't know that you can't separate the art from the person. You can separate the art from the person. I think it becomes harder, again, with someone like Bill Cosby because it is so many people. Like, so many people have come forward and said that he has done this thing. Whereas with Woody Allen, it's just one person. And that doesn't mean she's lying. It just means that it's not 100% factual and we can't...
Well, you look at it as well at the surrounding of how it came about, going through a bitter divorce. You know, people sling mud at people, or shit, if you like. So you kind of look at that and go, oh, maybe she was coaching the kid, maybe, just to sort of give him a bad rep.
You don't know, and lots of things are possible, and people are on one side and people are on the other, but ultimately, you don't see a lot of people podcasting about Woody Allen or even talking about Woody Allen anymore, which is kind of a bit bizarre.
I think it's, I mean, you know, people have the views on certain things, especially regarding this. But
I just think that normally, if something like where there's smoke, there's fire, right? And that can go to this one incident. But normally, if an incident like this comes to light, and you have a psychological problem where you are sexually attracted to children, which is pedophilia, a multitude of other people would come forward, or at least another person would come forward. Maybe not a multitude, but maybe one other person would feel emboldened and brave to do so based on the constant revelations that Dylan Farrow has done. That, again, that's not to say this isn't true. However, I think in this case with Woody Allen, because of his length and breadth of work and because of the quality of his very best films, you have to separate the art from the artist. Because, first of all, if you don't, you start going down a slippery slope and you go, well, where do I stop? Because there are plenty of artists, musicians, and whatever who have done terrible things in their lives and we still praise their work. Secondly, if you do it, I think you miss out on some of the greatest comedy of any age, of any writing, of any movie making, of any
stand-up comedy.
Yeah.
Yeah, you'd certainly be missing out. He's made some pretty strong masterpieces, in my opinion.
Yeah, I mean, he's had a healthy run. We've covered some of his stuff on the show before. We covered some of his stuff with Matt Farley before we did Deconstructing Harry and Stardust Memories, because they were sort of thematically similar.
Yeah.
But this is sort of the first time we're doing one of his sort of, I think, you know, big, well-known, influential classic movies in Annie Hall. But we did the musical ones as well. We did Everyone Says I Love You and
Sweet and Low Down.
But I think, like, Annie Hall is one, it's sort of one of those moments in art. It's a bit like Hey Jude or Holy Grail. And I'll explain that just to say that those are two things that it doesn't really matter who you speak to, what walk of life they're from, what upbringing they had, what country they're from, whatever it is. You can put on Hey Jude or Monty Python's Holy Grail and 90% of people love it, right?
Yeah.
And Annie Hall is sort of that. You don't. It's the one movie of Woody Allen's where you don't have to be a neurotic, a comedy fan, a Jew, or anything else to understand or love it. I don't think. I think it speaks to something more universal than that.
Well, it speaks to that thing called love, doesn't it?
It does. We're gonna be two young guys talking about adult love. the warm and special feeling one has for a man or a lady or an animal or whatever. It's a free world now. You can be whatever. You can be part man, part woman, and you can love another part man, part woman, and it's perfectly fine. But yes. I think Annie Hall speaks to all of it. It speaks to the internal fight, not the external one, although there are external fights in it.
Does that make sense? Oh, yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, definitely.
I think it does. I think the best thing about it is that the humor, the humor allows it to be both very human and real, while also being the kind of gateway drug you need to get into the more serious things that he's saying. Does that make sense? Like it's part the humor part speaks to just humanity's sense of humor and humanity's sense of lunacy, like the joke at the end with where he says, you know, I still need the eggs or whatever. It speaks yeah. It speaks to that, But it also, the humour is the bit of sugar that lets the medicine go down kind of thing.
Yeah, because, I mean, you know, if there was no comedy in it, it'd be quite a depressing film.
It would be interiors, and nobody sees watches that one.
Yeah, so it just speaks, it speaks on so many levels. And it's sort of, and it starts off at the start, spoilers, by him saying, we broke up. You know, and it's, I think it did shape the way the 80s and 90s romantic comedies were going.
Well, the interesting thing is Annie Hall is not a movie that's about when will they get together. Like, that's not the point of the film. Like, so many of the ones that come subsequent to this, the ending of, and the ones I hate, the endings always take place just as the woman who is always portrayed as an idiot who needs a man to survive.
Yeah.
Makes the wrong decision and is about to marry the wealthy guy who's perfectly nice, but maybe shouted at her because he likes football and she doesn't or something. And she's about to marry him.
Have you read my new script?
When into the church bursts the foppish, poor, pretty awful, but slightly lovable and more hunky leading man. And the woman goes, I've made it too. Mistake and runs off with him. And that's normally where rom-coms go. Anything with fucking Kay Hudson or any of the other Meg Ryan ones. I mean, just and not just rom-coms, but some comedies, you look at even laddish comedies nowadays have to have a love story throughout it. And even those love stories, the women are marginalized and minimalized and put down to being, they're either like, you know, I don't particularly like Katherine Heigl, but she had a point about Knocked Up. Like, she was playing a, you know, whiny, whingy
bitch,
which was, but it was written by a man, you know, and it was a man's, you know, meat-headed interpretation of what women are like. And that's not to say that some women aren't like that. That's just to say that the constant portrayal of them in movies is woefully inaccurate 9 times out of 10.
Yeah, and that's the great thing about Woody Allen. He writes great parts for women. I mean, so many women.
He used to. The later ones, not so much, but certainly in this prime Annie Hall, Hannah and Her Sisters era. Yes.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. Crimes and Misdemeanors as well, with Angelica Houston. She's great in that.
The best thing about Crimes and Misdemeanors and Angelica Houston is you actually feel sorry for her. You're not like with the guy. You actually think he's a total shit. Like, he's a total shit. And you actually feel sorry for this woman who might not be the sharpest tool in the shed, but she doesn't deserve what she gets by any means, you know?
No, she's been wronged.
So I think, and that's not to say, like, again, today it was so funny. There's that quote going around the internet with Louis C.K. talking about why he's voting for Hillary. And it's basically him kind of attacking like lazy, schlubby men for being crappy fathers and women, no matter what, even the like crappiest of mothers kind of go all out for their kids kind of thing is what he was talking about. And so therefore he's looking forward to having a bitch mother in the White House. And it's a joke, like it's a gag, it's a fucking comedy bit. But there was lots of people writing about, I don't think women should be marginalized to be mothers or oh, for fuck's sake. Not saying any of that. I'm just saying that the beauty and the joy of a Woody Allen thing, certainly of this period, is that all the characters are written in a human way with faults, foibles, and positives.
Yeah, I mean, that's a great thing about Woody Allen, because she, Diane Keaton in it, she starts off as that, you know, conventional dopey woman in, you know, romantic comedies from years gone by. And he sort of transforms her. And at the end, they don't stay together, and it's because he's kind of made her a better person. And he's changed her into something he wanted. And at the end, he's sort of like, no, I actually do want her back.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's... there's something to that interpretation of it, definitely, and I think that's a big part
of
it.
Not that you made him more intelligent, because your intelligence is there, but he gets to reading books, and after, you know, he's sort of like, oh shit, well, we're done.
I think he encourages what's already within her, and I think also, like, one of the things that I would, when I first watched this movie, think was funny, like him attacking some of her sillier likes or sillier interests. I think now I would be possibly more on her side in terms of the fact that, you know, just because they're her interests or just because that was her at that particular time in her life, like, doesn't mean it should be belittled necessarily.
Oh, definitely not, no.
But I think he equally belittles himself over and over again. I think that's where the acceptability comes from, is because he might be comically judgmental of other people, and he is repeatedly. And comedy has to be, you know, it has to be about judgment and negativity to some extent. He also turns that on himself. You know what I mean? He also is willing completely to be all the negative aspects of himself. And I think that, yeah, I mean, maybe there's that aspect of him being the learned one and her being, you know, unread or unpolished, maybe. But I think that the fact that she finally leaves him, it's more that his interests are very inward. They're like a funnel. They're not going anywhere. And yet her interests are only expanding. And she only wants... Like, he's not willing to... He's absolutely crippled by his neuroses and everything. He's not willing to travel. He's not willing to hang out with other people. He's not... You know, like, so much of his life is just like, I don't like any of this. I just want to be in this four square block radius of New York.
Yeah, it's his way or no way at all.
Right. And I think she's like, yeah, okay, you showed me this and you showed me that. But, you know, she's a photographer. She's a singer. She's, you know, a reader. She becomes interested in movies. Like, she, you know, expands and then just says, well, look, you're not going anywhere with me. So I got to move on, because I've got to look after myself.
Yeah, and go out with Paul Simon.
She does like midget bald guys.
She's definitely got a type.
Yeah. And what's funny is Diane Keaton has said in reality that Woody Allen, to her, was very sexy.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's why this screen chemistry is so good, because they did get... Yeah, I think they'd split up by this point, hadn't they?
I think so, but, yeah.
But they're still so close. And I think I read somewhere, I think it was from Tony Roberts, and he says that when they were making Play It Again, Sam on Broadway, that, you know, he could see that they were falling in love with each other, and she was absolutely besotted with him. And it kind of, you know, you look at Diane Keaton at that time, and she was hot.
Well, she's a very beautiful woman, yes.
Yeah. And then you look at Woody Allen, and you can just sort of go to yourself, fucking hell, there's hope for everyone.
Yeah, I mean, he, you know, going a little bit back to what we were saying at the beginning of the show, he is creepy. Like, he's a little weird, to say that, and I think he would probably even admit that. Like, to say that he is... you know, has quote-unquote whatever sort of normal impulses and or normal sexuality is, it is probably not right. But then I would also say that in terms of the characters he plays, I'm not talking about him in real life because I don't know him in real life, but in terms of the characters he plays, I think what's interesting about Woody Allen's characters, the male characters, and what's interesting about the way he writes is he actually writes from a very honest place in terms of sexuality and in terms of relationships and in terms of the internal thoughts. A lot of people, I think, go around, or certainly this is what I observe, and maybe I just do it. I don't know whether other people do. But a lot of people go around with this, like, well, this is what normal is, and therefore I won't talk about these other things unless it's in the context of a joke, and therefore I can just wave it off as not being really about me. Or it's with a select small group of private people who I can talk about. Or it's a club I go to where someone wraps me in cellophane and sticks an aubergine up my ass or whatever. Like, it's all a lot of that, like, sexuality, relationship stuff, personality stuff, the deep, dark parts of us, or what we as human society has deemed the deep, dark parts of us. A lot of that is kept hidden in reality, in the real world, as we go out and about. And I'm not saying that Woody Allen, like, sits around and talks about, you know, sort of S&M or anything that would be deemed sort of on the fringe of sexuality. Yeah. But he does talk about male-female sexuality in a very frank way, that, and not in a childish, laddish way, like anal sex or blowjobs, but like in a... You know what I'm saying? I don't know. I'm boring myself.
No. I get what you said. I mean, I like, you know, the bit in Annie where he gets out the red light.
Yeah.
He gets out the red light and you just think to yourself, that probably happened.
Right.
Where he was sort of like, I know all this makeup, this will make it really hot if I get this, if we buy a red light.
If I buy a red light, yeah.
Yeah. And he's put that in the movie. Yeah. I always think to myself, does that work?
Yeah. Does that work? But it's more that idea of experimentation and making a joke out of the nervous insanity that we all go through to either be happy or be aroused or be in love or whatever it is. It's what did he say? He said a really good thing on his Parkinson interview years ago. I think it's a quote from another poet, but I think it's something to do with the unfathomable desirability of women. I think that's what he says. And something to do with sort of being driven berserk by them.
Well, it's you watch Annie Hall, and afterwards you're with Woody Allen as a male. I'm with Woody Allen. I'm like, yeah, I don't think we'll ever figure him out.
Right.
You know, it's such a, you know, I've got three daughters, you know, a gorgeous wife, but I'll never figure him out.
No.
Never. And if Woody Allen can't, I sure as fuck can't.
Yeah, I think it's, I mean, if anything that I've learned, or I think I've learned, I'm not assuming any kind of knowledge, but my feeling is that there isn't that much different. And actually, what a lot of guys have issue with when they come to think about women is that idea that, well, wait a minute, they're women. They're different. They're this, they're that. They're all this other stuff. Like,
yeah, when they go out with their friends, they probably talk about shopping and new shoes. But they don't. They probably just talk like as blokes.
Right. And it's, like, and also the idea that...
which is kind of frightening.
Oh, no, but it's also wonderful. Like, I was...
It's great, but... Males are so, you know, we can act all secure, but the fact that some women are going out, you know, and they're talking about the sex lives and everything, for some blokes, that's like a big insecurity. Probably will be to me, because, Claire's friends will find out about the huge dildo we've got.
Yeah, exactly. the range of novelty Walt Disney-themed butt plugs.
Yeah, and she one of her friends will go, he's got a red light. Yeah, he's already in a Woody Allen film.
Does he play jazz music? Yes. Yes, he does.
He won't take those glasses off.
No, I think it's more that it's more our inability to see ourselves that makes our inability to see other genders and or other sexualities and or other people. I think the more you can see yourself and the more you can see the faults, the complexities, the insecurities, and so on in yourself, the more you can look around and go, oh, yeah, they're all just doing what I'm doing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I think that our hardest thing is not looking at everyone else. Our hardest thing is looking at ourselves. That being said, there is, of course, the nature side of things, because it's always nature versus nurture. There's the nature side of things that, that obviously plays into femininity and women and their, you know, biology and various other things, but that we don't understand because we, and it's not that we're not able to comprehend them. It's just that we're not able to empathize with them because we don't go through it. Like we have no, like, you know, the big joke with women is like, fuck, if men went through periods, we'd never hear the end of it. And it's true. And it's true because like, we have no idea what that's like. That, like, there's no way to possibly at all, understand what it's like, except, I don't know, slicing your balls open once a month. But I mean, I had no idea. Like,
I did that.
but I just mean, it comes down to an experience, and that's just an obvious one using that, but there's lots of different experiences. And while most experiences that men go through are either irrelevant and or women are able to go through them, a lot of the experiences that women go through, men are just physically not able to go through with them. And it's like the oppression thing, or the sexist thing, or the people leering and catcalling and ogling them and whatever. Like, men will never know that. Like, even if a couple of women or a couple of gay guys or whatever it is give you a passing glance, that's like, that's so rare, it's ridiculous. And maybe it happens like one, but like, every woman I know, the one sort of uniting trait they have is they walk out the front door and immediately have to be on their guard. Immediately.
Yeah, they're immediately sexualized.
They suffer a threat that we don't. You know what I mean? I don't walk down the road and think that anyone's going to ogle me or possibly jump out of a car and drag me onto the back seat or whatever it is. Like, I have no concept of what that feels like to live without on a daily basis. So there's that stuff. But I think in the very, and not to downplay, but at the very core level, I think we're kind of similar. I just think our experiences differ. And I think
that is so true. That's, I did a joke about in stand-up one time, and I said the difference between male and females, you know, is, you know, a woman will have a baby and they'll say how painful it is. I said my wife, she said that, you know, it's one of the worst, you know, it's the worst pain she's ever had, but she had three kids, so it's painful,
right?
But you get through it, and that's fantastic. I said, but I've had a vasectomy. That was really painful. I'll never do it again.
Right.
So that probably is the most painful thing, isn't it? And that didn't go too down too well.
No, but I mean, I understand where you're coming from. It's a good joke. but no, and I think that, I don't know why.
It's not good at an all-women's event.
No, probably not. But it's not insulting either. It makes sense.
No, it's, yeah.
What you're trying to say is don't have children because they're awful and it's painful.
Yep, and I'm skin.
Yeah. But so for people who haven't seen Annie Hall, we've just spoken 30 minutes about male...
complexities of it.
The complexities of male and female relationships.
There is a point to it because I think it's probably one of the first films... one of the first romantic comedies. I think it's probably from really a male perspective, even though women can watch it. Do you know what I mean? It's written by Woody Allen, and it's sort of how a bloke goes through a relationship. Whereas certainly, you know, like when you say about the Kate Hudson films, I don't think I could watch one of those and relate. Whereas I watch Woody Allen, Annie Hall, and I really do relate to it.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's possibly true. I I don't know. I would honestly have to ask a woman who is as big a fan of Woody Allen as we are.
They could definitely get something out of it. I'm just saying, from a personal point of view, I watch that and I can really sort of connect with it. Whereas some romantic comedies, there's absolutely no way I can connect with them.
Right.
You know, Bridget Jones film, I can't connect with that at all. I suppose that's the good thing about Woody Allen, because I'm sure women can connect with Annie Hall.
Right. Yeah, I think that... Yeah, there's certainly things. I mean, Bridget Jones is probably a better example than any of the Kate Hudson films, because they tend to be very badly written. And at least Bridget Jones is about its core. It's about the like female experience of being a certain age and working and men and all the rest of it. Like up until a point. Like at a certain point, then fucking Colin Darcy and Floppy. Grant throwing each other through fucking windows and fucking bad disco music is playing, and you know, at a certain point that movie just becomes fucking stupid, and that's my problem with a lot of these things, and not for any good reason either, just because it's like, oh, wouldn't it be great to see two guys with like a wet shirt be thrown through a window, and that's fine, and maybe that speaks to a female sense of humor that I'm not in touch with, you know, but I think I can relate to the first half of that movie in terms of female friends I've had and understanding. I can't obviously go through that experience necessarily, but I can certainly see where the film's coming from and what's going on and empathize.
Yeah, I mean,
with her character.
I'm not knocking the movie at all, you know, it's done really well, and you know, my wife loves them, so I'm certainly not knocking him. I'm just saying I can't sort of watch it and go, yeah, I'm a bit like Bridget Jones.
Yeah, I've been there and done that. Yeah, no, I know. I completely understand. No, and it's interesting. A lot of the films that I like, or used to like, I would say, more so, things like Taxi Driver. Weirdly enough, things like With Nell and I, they're not, yes, because they've got male protagonists and so on and so forth, but they're not ones that women tend to gravitate towards, because I think it's speaking to I think in a weird way, and I might be completely wrong, but they're kind of speaking to a loneliness that women
with
Nell
and I, certainly.
No, right, but Taxi Driver and to some extent parts of Annie Hall are speaking to a loneliness or a neuroses that maybe you can't say women aren't in touch with, but just generally from the perspective of the leading characters in those three films,
yeah,
they're not in touch with. In the same way that, you know, I watched Taxi Driver at 19, and no, I had no concept of the politics involved or the idea of the world around me like actually being filled with scumbags. But I felt like my life was filled with scumbags. I was able to... associate with that leading character. And I think in the same way that growing up, I would associate myself far more with the Woody Allen character in Annie Hall, whereas now I would watch it possibly somewhat detached, because I don't necessarily have those insecurities like I used to.
Yeah, and that's weird, isn't it? Because, I mean, he's... when he made Annie Hall, and if he was speaking from his, you know, his viewpoint of life at that age, he was actually older than us.
Right.
Now, so he's sort of not got past those insecurities, right, even at that age.
And I don't know, like, I don't know that I'm 100. I'm sat here as someone who's very happy in his relationship and very happy in his love life. And in fact, it's the one thing I don't have anxiety and insecurity about right now. I have anxiety and insecurity about money and jobs and, you know, the website and friendships and various other things. But I, like, relationship is not one thing that I'm worrying about right now. And so I think that when I watch Annie Hall now, it's more as a comedy, because I'm still able to relate and laugh at it, than I am necessarily seeing all the relationship stuff, because it's relationship stuff that I've probably been through in the past. You know what I mean? Let's not say that
that I'm the perfect living embodiment of wonderfulness. I'm just saying that right now I'm not going through anything that I could relate to in Annie Hall.
No? I don't know. I think I can. You know, I'm not a lot of people know this about me, but I am a Jewish comedian living in New York.
Right.
So, you know, I was originally a 19-year-old driving a taxi cab. That's why I related so much to Taxi Driver when
right,
I was
exactly.
18 and 19, yeah.
But no, there are vast swathes of Annie Hall that I don't... and for people who are sat here listening to this, not that they would be at this point, but like listening to it going, you haven't summarized the plot. Like, you've either seen it or you haven't. I mean, if you want to know...
It's boy meets girl, boy loses girl.
Yeah, it's a stand-up comedian living in New York, and he meets... A woman who he falls madly in love with, but who has a complicated relationship with, and they break up, get back together, break up, and then eventually break up. It's all his neuroses and insecurities around that. But there's sort of vast ways of the Woody Allen character that I don't recognize myself in. Like, I wouldn't go and see the sorrow and the pity, you know?
No. I mean, that sort of thing. I would never go and see that. I do get pissed off if I miss the start of the movie.
Yeah, no, see, now that bit is... Yeah, that bit is totally relatable. In fact, I used to have a running gag with one of my old friends, Amy, when I was in England and we would go see movies. And I would say... that line about because I'm anal that way, like I have to be there at the very beginning because I'm anal that way, and she would say that's a polite word for what you are, and we used to do that joke all the time because I'm like that. Yeah, I want to be in the theater, preferably for the trailers. You know, preferably for the trailers. I want to sit down. Yeah. Although nowadays, fuck trailers.
yeah. And also, you know, when is it Marshall McLuhan comes out of the, you know?
Right. Yeah.
And he can't let that guy have his say.
Right.
I'm kind of like it like that. I was at a family dinner one time, and there was people there I didn't really know. And they were saying about, I think it was when Kill Bill was released, and this guy says, yeah, because in Kill Bill, when he does the sword fights, it goes to black and white because it's more stylish.
Yeah.
And I should have just gone, yeah. But no, I interrupted his conversation to say, actually, that's... He had to do that because if he didn't, the film would have been cut. It's not stylistic at all. I should have just let him live in his world of thinking, you know, him thinking that he's noticed something great about a Tarantino movie. And I was the douchebag who had to say, actually, you're wrong.
But I think what's funny about that scene is that nowadays on the internet, that's the entire internet. I spend my day... in forums and things where I see people, especially since Ash vs. Evil Dead came out, and I see so many people talking about Evil Dead in such an incorrect way, you know what I mean? Like calling the first one a comedy and
what, Evil Dead?
Yeah, and talking because they watch it ironically, they laugh at the acting and they laugh at the effect and whatever because they're hipster fucks. And you know, people getting things wrong, like, well, Evil Dead 2 is a remake, and Army of Darkness, you know, the one ending is this and one ending is that and blah, blah, blah. Like, they get it all wrong. They just get it all wrong. And so I spend my day going, don't say anything, don't say anything, don't say anything. Because you know that I got into a conversation the other day about the Evil Dead remake, where literally the guy was arguing with me that it wasn't a remake, it was a reboot. Like, that was his whole argument. I was like, listen, dude, look. You could call it a fucking cabbage on a stick. I don't give a fuck what you call it. It's a remake, and I'm not going to give it any money because fuck remakes. Like, I'm just, that's my principle, my opinion. And he was like, no, but they said this and they said that and the thing. And I'm like, I know. I've read every interview. I've listened to everything. Like, I know. I've been an Evil Dead fan for like 25 years. I know, dude. Like, I get it. And I kept saying, can we just finish this, please? Because I'm like, it's fine. I get it. You think one thing, I think another. Let's just happily go on our way. And he was like, no, but it's a reboot because blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, there is no dictionary definition for this, ass face. Stop going on about it.
Yeah. Well, you were talking to Sam Raimi, weren't you?
Yeah, I was. Yeah. But yeah, so... I feel like that whole scene on the cinema line is definitely what I go through on a daily basis. But I think that the benefit Annie Hall has as a movie comedically is that he's able to draw on his stand-up, which, whether people like him or not, is some of the funniest fucking stand-up that was ever done.
The Moose sketch that I sent to you, Messenger, is one of the funniest sketch stand-up bits, routines you will ever see.
Right. And it, but even perfect. Even his rare stuff, even there's a couple of albums, they've actually been re-released on CD now, but even his rarer stuff, all of it is amazing. Like, all of it is funny. And so it benefits from him being able to do that and even use some of the jokes about, like, looking into the soul of the boy next to me when he's cheating on his metaphysics final. But it also benefits from his having made a lot of, you know, slapstick and or verbal and or comedic films before this.
He really got it out of his system, and Love and Death is one of the funniest films.
I mean, I would think if you're into stand-up and you don't... like, because Annie Hall does what stand-up does, which is that it looks at the absurdities of the world around us, or the world around the stand-up. So stand-up varies, obviously, depending on your experiences, but... it looks at the absurdities in the life and the world that you are living in. And Annie Hall does that for 2 hours while telling a narrative story as well. But it's essentially a stand-up routine. Like, the film is essentially a stand-up routine.
Because, I mean, he starts with him talking to the camera directly.
Right, yeah, completely.
And it's like he's starting off his stand-up routine, and you're just going into his memory to see his stand-up routine, which is what you kind of do with a good stand-up anyway.
Yeah, and I think that where this benefits and where this movie and we'll move on to Manhattan Murder Mystery soon because we're running long already. But where this movie benefits, I think, from not feeling like his earlier knockabout slapstick comedies was definitely the influence of the cinematographer. Who shoot Gordon Willis, who collaborated with him on lots of movies. But he makes the movie look autumnal. You know what I mean? Like, it's got that kind of New York autumnal. It's rich, but it's also dull and gray. It's sort of.
You can see the difference when they go to Los Angeles in it.
Right. Of course. Yeah. And that's a very definite bit, but and maybe it's also the fact that I don't know, but like a lot of those like more knockabout laddish boy comedies tend to be filmed more in out west, or certainly tend to be filmed in that, like, comedy should be filmed in bright color, you know.
Let's all go to Vegas.
Right, it has to be shot in that kind of way where it looks hyper real. Whereas what's interesting about what you've got Woody Allen doing stuff like Annie Hall, where it, you know, he's playing with tones, he's playing with colors, he's playing with shading, he's shooting stuff realistically. You've got Mel Brooks making spoof movies, but shot like you would shoot a serious movie. So you look at the way that Young Frankenstein and Blazing Saddles and his like key movies are shot. They're shot using the lighting palette and the style of those genres. Very well done. And
Blazing Saddles looks like the quintessential 50s Western.
Right. It's amazing.
It looks so good.
It really does. And then you've got people like Monty Python in the 70s, doing sequences in, like, you can't get a sillier film than Holy Grail, but there's sequences in that that look like, you know, they were able to turn a 20 grand movie into a, you know, $1 million Arthurian looking crazy epic because of the way Gilliam and Terry Jones were able to shoot and design stuff. And, you know, famously Cleese would say, you know, where's the comedy in Smoke, or where's the comedy in mud, or why do I have to sit in this costume in the rain and all the rest of it. Like, he would bitch about it. But, like, the reason why the comedy in Holy Grail works is that it is juxtaposed against the absurdity of it being this big, serious epic. And then into that, these ridiculous characters. If it looked like just a sketch show or a sketch film, it wouldn't work as well.
No, you may as well just stick it on TV.
So that's where the comedy comes from in Smoke. Sorry to disagree with John Cleese, comedy legend and icon. And to some extent, Woody Allen is doing that with this. He's making it look like a serious drama. And then suddenly he will do subtitles under a pretentious conversation about photography.
That's great. Because that is every relationship, isn't it?
Yeah, well, you're sitting there trying to be interesting, and really in your head you're just being like, what the fuck am I talking about?
Yeah, she sees what I'm really like.
Yeah, and it's kind of what it's like doing this podcast, because I kind of sit here talking about it and wanting to be articulate, but then in my head going, my God, you're a pretentious asshole. Like, so I am self-aware, people.
I'm not.
No. We are all individuals.
I'm not.
but no, so I think he's kind of doing that here. I mean, maybe not consciously. Maybe he's just wanting to make, you know, he's a bit of a pretentious arty guy himself. So maybe he wants to make something that's a bit more beautiful, and maybe he wants to make something that's a bit more of a love letter to New York.
He definitely is in his films, and then you sort of see him in his interviews, and he's sort of like, no, I just watch sports. And you're like,
yeah.
So who's the character in the film? Maybe he just writes himself different. Maybe he writes himself the way he wants to be himself.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I think he, like, in a
although
weird...
Although he does watch a lot of Bergman, and that shines through in some of his films, doesn't it?
What's that?
He watches a lot of Bergman.
Bergman, yeah.
Yeah.
No, I mean, I think when he brings up sports and stuff, I think it's more him saying, I'm a regular guy, like, I'm not just... Like, I had to learn about Bergman, and I had to learn about art, and I had to learn about this stuff. Like, I wasn't just, you know, I'm a Brooklyn boy who likes baseball. You know what I mean? Mm. The fact that I happen to have read a little bit or watched some movies, all of that is accessible to everyone. The fact that people choose not to do that, it, you know, is up to them.
Yeah.
But it doesn't, I don't think what he's always fought against is this idea that somehow he's an intellectual. Because I don't think he sees himself as that way. And in a weird way, he's sort of like the original hipster in that he wears corduroy and still types everything out on a typewriter, even though computers were invented fucking decades ago.
Yeah, but we can forgive him that.
No, totally. Because, I mean, like, he's been doing it since the late 50s, so it's absolutely...
Yeah, because you go up to him and say, what kind of thing are you into? You just be like, this is what I've always done.
Right.
Well, have you got any Frank Zappa? And he'd be like, who's Frank Zappa?
Who's Frank Zappa? it is what it is what it is. But I think that Annie Hall has something in it for everybody. I think the fact that, even when the female in the movie is ridiculed by Woody being superior or pompous or whatever... You don't side with him, you side with her. Like, ultimately, yeah. You're like, Jesus, lay off her. Like, whatever. But I tell you what, I think that the other thing is the great thing about Diane Keaton in this movie is that she's sort of, like, I think they call them, like, pixie dream girls now, which is a fucking horrible expression. But she's one of those first sort of women I can think of in movies where she's not pristine. Like, she is scrappy and she is verbal and she is drives like a maniac and she is messy. And, you know, she does sort of like dress her own way and do her own thing. Like, she's not.
And that's one of the great things as well. You know, he puts down her driving. And then the joke is, he's even shitter than her.
Of course.
With driving, which is great.
Well, because he's nervous. Like, she's confident and brash. And you have to say to yourself, that's what's, to a certain type of guy, that's what's sexually attractive, or that's what's just generally attractive about that kind of woman, is that she is
yes, she's willing to learn. Yes, she's willing to be supported, but she's also headstrong in her own stuff. She has her own likes and dislikes. She has her own interests. She does her own thing. She does drive like a maniac, and that is wonderful. Like, more fool him for not being able to keep up, you know? And it, I think there's a lot of positivity to be taken from it, I think.
Yeah, and also, can't not mention one of the best cameos of all time by Christopher Walken as her brother Dwayne.
Well, this movie's full of great cameos. You've got her brother Dwayne, played by Christopher Walken, who says when he's driving along, he looks into the headlights of the oncoming car, thinks about driving into them, and then you cut, and there's that hilarious scene.
Driving.
Where she's like, brother, our brother Dwayne will take us to the airport.
In the driving. And you just see this, the shot goes from Christopher Walken to Diane Keaton to Woody Allen, and he looks the most uncomfortable you've ever seen anyone. It's fantastic. It's so funny.
I think if it didn't laugh so much at himself, and if it did sort of put him above everyone,
it wouldn't work.
It wouldn't work. I think he's in the thick of it, and he's just as fucked up as everyone else, I think, is the idea. And then, of course, the other great cameo is Jeff Goldblum as the guy who's forgotten his mantra at the party. And it's also really funny because it is a movie in which a New York stand-up comedian hipster living his little, like, hip New York life, going to, like, you know, cinemas and galleries and things like that, goes to LA, and just because there's a party and everyone is enjoying themselves, like, instantly fucking hates it. Like, it is a New Yorker commenting on what he sees to be LA's frivolousness, but there's just as much frivolity and stupidity in New York, to be honest.
Oh yeah, definitely. I just sort of thinking about some of my favourite scenes. One of my favourite scenes when he's talking about riding the dodgems when he was right. A kid, and he says, "I used to really get my aggression out on those things." And he's a kid, and his car's getting battered.
Yeah, I mean, it is funny from start to finish. It's truthful from start to finish, even in its flights of fancy, even in the moments where it's clearly not realistic, it's still truthful. It's a stand-up comedy routine made into a movie in a way that I don't think has really been...
Oh, it's been tried bettered So many times, and nobody's ever succeeded. And it's... People have tried, and, you know, that kind of goes into the film with, like, you know, with the lobsters.
Right, yeah.
That's, like, the pivotal part of their relationship. It's, you know, when they're the most, you know, they're having fun, they're in love, and he tries that again with another woman.
Oh, never go back, yeah, never go back. That's awful.
And he sort of is like, no, she was kind of perfect.
And you can't kind of repeat those moments. Like, moments have to happen organically. You can't, like, force an issue.
Yeah.
And it's closest rival competitor, and a movie that's clearly influenced massively by it is When Harry Met Sally.
Yeah, I was just going to say When Harry Met Sally, yeah.
And I think where When Harry Met Sally to some extent improves on Annie Hall was the addition of a female behind the scenes, because it was co-written with Rob Reiner, and Nora Ephron. So when Harry Met Sally kind of betters Annie Hall, certainly improves on it, I think, is the addition of Nora Ephron as a co-writer with Rob Reiner. So you've got that female perspective.
Yeah.
And also the fact that Billy Crystal and Meg Ryan were also able to improvise within their roles and bring the male and female perspective. And I think, therefore, if you're going to sit down with a girl or with a female friend or whoever you're sitting down with, and you want one that's maybe more speaks to both sides of the experience,
I think that When Harry Met Sally improves on it there. And is equally as funny and brilliant. But you know, without Annie Hall, there isn't. Without Annie Hall, there aren't really the rom-coms that people know today, and there certainly isn't When Harry Met Sally without Annie Hall.
No, it influenced so many rom-coms. Very much so. And no Kate Hudson film has done.
No, fuck Kate Hudson. I mean, my biggest problem with the rom-coms that have come subsequently from other filmmakers is that they go, instead of taking a more modern approach, they take the tried and tested damsel in distress and or Pride and Prejudice route.
Yeah, every woman needs to be saved, and
even
she
if,
will be.
Even if the intention of the writer or the actor or whatever is not to bring that across, that's invariably what happens. That's invariably how it seems or how it feels. I don't think it's been done with quite the finesse that it's been done in Annie Hall. I don't know. No. I really like Annie Hall. It's great. If you haven't seen it, check it out.
It's definitely, yes.
It's funny as fuck.
It's funny as fuck, mate.
It's funny as fuck, mate. And and it's really well directed. Looks brilliant. It's got a great score. And it's the quintessential Woody Allen movie.
Yes, it's my favourite Woody Allen film. Damn sure. Because it's the first one I watched as well, so...
It was certainly a really early one for me. And I remember also thinking that, and this maybe speaks to his lack of pretension maybe in real life, or lack of intellectualism or something, is you can watch the movie... I watched this movie probably when I was 12 or 13, maybe younger. Mm. And all the references fly over your head. I have no idea to this day, really, who Marshall McLuhan is.
I still don't know who he is.
Or what The Sorrow and the Pity is, other than they mentioned it's a 3-hour documentary about Nazis. But you can watch it without needing to know that stuff. You can watch it without needing to know... And in the same way you can enjoy the... Bruce's philosopher's song in Monty Python without having to know who any of those philosophers are or what their philosophies were. And I think that, and if you learn something watching it, if you're like, well, I want to check out photography, or I want to check out The Sorrow and the Pity, or I want to learn who Marshall McLuhan is or whatever it is. Great. So much the better. But like, you can also just watch it as a comedy.
Yeah. Yeah.
A drama.
To help you shake off the doldrums and dust off the blues of this ridiculous election season, this winter, Slingshot Cops, the awesome supernatural buddy cop comedy, is coming to a movie theater near you. That is if you live in the northeast of America, or if you happen to be in San Francisco, California. Yes, that's right. The fantastic, awesome Motown Media and Shock Marathons produced Slingshot Cops, starring Matt Farley, Kevin McGee, Sharon Scalzo, Jim McHugh, Elizabeth Peterson, Jim Farley, Chris Peterson, and all your favorites from the world of podcasting, Cole Reel, Brendan Walsh, Randy Lichtke, Jay Mayo, John Cross, Jim Wallace, and so much more is coming to Massachusetts on November the 12th. There are two screenings, 5 p.m. and 7:15 p.m. at Tapley Memorial Hall. That's on 13 Page Street, Danvers, Massachusetts. The information will be at aftermoviediner.com and moturnmedia.com. Check it out. That's the Massachusetts premiere on November the 12th. Or you could catch the California premiere on November 18th at 7 p.m. at the Roxy Theater. The information will be at aftermoviediner.com and motownmedia.com. Then there's the Connecticut premiere on November the 26th at 5 p.m. at the Strand Theater. The Rhode Island premiere at December 14th, 1 p.m. Comedy Connection.
And then there's a New York premiere, that's upstate New York, really, December the 10th, 7 p.m. at the Bundy Museum of History and Art. Find out all the information about the Slingshot Cops premiere tour of New England, the Northeast, and California on aftermoviediner.com or moternmedia.com. That's M-O-T-E-R-N media.com. Be there or miss out on the greatest supernatural buddy slingshot-carrying cop comedy of your life. Now, this one, Manhattan Murder Mystery, is also one written by Woody Allen and his writing partner, Marshall Brickman. As I said, it utilizes some early stuff from Annie Hall.
Yeah, so it could be seen as what if they stayed together.
Right. It stars Woody Allen and Diane Keaton again, but with the fantastic, hilarious addition of Alan Alda and Angelica Houston, who are phenomenally good in the film. And it's less... it's sort of... There are relationship stuff. There is relationship stuff in it. There is, definitely. It's more
like the undercurrent.
Yeah.
It's what's brimming underneath. What's the main focus point is. It is, because it's kind of like the relationships between Diane Keaton and Woody Allen sort of gone a bit stale. If you know what I mean. It's not stale, but they've sort of, you know, they're in a routine.
Yeah.
And this is like a bright spark that all of a sudden has come into their life, that she thinks that the next door neighbor has killed his wife.
Yeah, it's sort of like, you know, there's Rear Window aspects to it. Obviously, they don't witness anything, but like they hear it. So there's Rear Window aspects to it. The whole movie is her convinced that a crime has been committed and him less than convinced and wanting really to just kind of go back to whatever marriage they had before this. Meanwhile, Alan Alda, because he's equally schlubbing about his apartment, doing nothing.
He's just got divorced.
He is more than happy to tag along with Diane Keaton, and therefore he presents a threat to Woody Allen. And then Angelica Houston is the unbelievably like tall and attractive author that is incredibly like forward and forthright with everyone, and who Woody, you know, clearly has a crush on.
She clearly has a crush on him as well.
Yeah, she does and she doesn't. Like, she's a bit kind of forward and flirty with everyone in the movie. So it's difficult. Yes, she does like him, but, like, it's more just her character, because she's like that with Alan Alda later in the movie too.
Yeah.
She's just a very headstrong, flirtatious, forward, creative, inventive person.
Yeah, she don't need no man to define her.
No. No, not in any way. Fuck the police. I don't even know what that means. But fuck the popo. What?
You can call 911, but I shan't give a shit.
I literally have no shits to give. Smash the patriarchy. Down with men. So we are awful. Anyway, the nice thing about this movie is that you are hoping beyond all hope, or at least I am when I'm watching it, that Alan and Diane Keaton stay together. Like, you really don't want Woody Allen to do anything with Angelica Houston, and you don't want Diane Keaton to fall for Alan Alda's charms. You just don't.
No, because he'd already done that in Husbands and Wives.
Yes, but with, you know, someone that a lot younger.
Yeah.
Weirdly.
And that,
there's no evidence in real life, but on his movies, he's...
Yeah, I mean, that's the problem, isn't it? You know, when he made his movies, and he goes, well, can you go back and look over my film career? You could say, oh, fuck, don't do that.
Yeah, don't look at Manhattan, where where she's actually underage. And don't look at her husbands and wives, where she's a college student and he's like 80. Don't look at the fact that he cast Scarlett Johansson in four movies. But no, so it, I mean, it, whatever.
Well, Manhattan Murder Mystery is just like a 1940s, 1950s sleuthy kind of comedy caper, just made in the 90s.
Yeah, it's also, I think, one of his most successful later films.
Mm.
I really, I think Manhattan Murder Mystery is sort of pretty much perfect. Like, there's nothing in it that I would really change. And it's pretty much a perfect script. And beautifully played by everyone in it. And while Annie Hall certainly has more substance to it, an analytical weight to it, or whatever that means, pretentious drivel, Manhattan Murder Mystery is just a good, fun, funny romp.
There's some cracking one-liners in it from everyone. Everybody gets the shot.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? You know, for a lot of people, if Woody Allen's the writer, he's the
what
one
are you
who's...
doing up? You know, we should be back in bed in one of our many cuddling positions.
Oh, the funniest line is at the end where when he's talking about Alan Alda, and he says, take away the elevated heels and the hair, what do you have? And she goes, you. And he goes, that's very good. Oh, it's so good. It's such a good film.
It is. It's a great movie. And it's... I mean, I don't know if the murder mystery is the weakest thing in it. But it doesn't matter, because it's such a... It's such a fun time with all these characters, and it's in a weird way, for all his relationship movies, and considering him and Diane Keaton's marriage is on the rocks, not on the rocks, but sort of stale at the beginning of the movie. It's one of his most positive movies and uplifting movies. Do you know what I mean? Like, it has that moment where, you know, once he gets involved and he's on the case with her, it becomes really touching in places and exciting in places.
It does, yeah, because they've got the spark back.
I love the bit where he's in the elevator and he's like, it's a claustrophobic nightmare. It's a stalled elevator in the dark with a dead body. There's some great bits like that. Sorry, you were saying, dude, so.
Yeah, no, but when they've been to the hotel... and they get back and they're just in bed talking about it. And he says, let's go to, there's a place open. It's 1 o'clock in the morning. Let's go and talk to Ted and Angelica Houston's character.
Marsha Fox. Yeah.
Yeah. And they've got the spark back and they're just chatting. They're just going over everything. It's so good. It's really good. And I love the bit as well where,
also, I have to say, cards. I would love to say at 1 a.m, hey, that place is open, let's go and just do that. That would be amazing.
Yeah. Yeah, because, I mean, that to me is oh, God, I wish I lived in fucking New York.
Right.
And go and investigate a murder and go out with my mates and chat about it.
Because that's what we all do.
That's what you and Kim do, isn't it? That's what you're doing after you've recorded tonight.
Yeah, that's what we do. We're going to go out and get hipster Chinese somewhere.
Yeah.
No,
yeah.
We're not actually. We're just going to make some pasta we made last night and heat it back up on the stove.
Yeah, yeah, but then you're going to go out and talk to Alan Alda and Angelica Houston, about your neighbour.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
That's what you do.
It's what we all do.
Yeah. That's what you've got to do.
This movie has Joy Behar in it from The View.
Does it?
Apparently
it's also got Zach Braff in it, isn't it?
Yeah, he plays their son.
Yeah, I don't think he says much in it.
So sadly, we have Woody Allen to blame for Zach Braff.
Yeah, because it's his first film, isn't it?
It marked Zach Braff's film debut.
Yeah. Thanks, Woody, for all the good stuff you've done. You brought him into the world. And to be quite honest, Zach Braff is one of the biggest Woody Allen wannabes.
Yeah. Definitely, definitely.
Got in state and all that.
So my favorite, like one of my favorite scenes, one of the scenes that I feel is like very realistic, is the sequence where they're staking out Helen Moss's apartment, and they're in the car and it's raining, and Alan Alda and Diane Keaton are having that tiptoe around our earlier flirtation. Or earlier in our life, flirtation conversation.
Oh, when they stayed at the hotel together.
Yeah, they recount a story about when they stayed at a hotel together.
Yeah.
And, you know, obviously he's more into the idea than she is. but she is also...
Well, she's flattered.
She's flattered by it, yes. I don't think I... Do you ever get the impression that she would cheat? I don't get that impression. I don't see that... is ever. I think Woody Allen's probably thought about cheating with Angelica Houston more than once. But I don't...
yeah, probably.
In the bathroom at work.
Yeah. Oh, my God, she's so gorgeous.
Oh, my God, she's like three times the height of me. But they have that great scene where they're playing cards.
Oh, when he's flipping the cards.
He's flipping cards.
He's rearranging his cards. He's fucking brilliant.
I just like any time like Woody Allen gets to do like physical comedy, I just think it's brilliant. You know, there was a point where Woody Allen was the perfect blend of Groucho Marx and Buster Keaton. And it's and yeah, obviously hugely influenced by both those people.
Yeah, but he doesn't deny it.
No, not at all. In fact, the other one is Bob Hope. He always says like Bob Hope always had like the one liner in the movies, and he patented his like little thing after Bob Hope. But yeah, what to say about Manhattan Murder Mystery? It's got the look of that Woody in New York movie, but it's also a lot more like handheld, right? It's got like a lot more.
Yeah, it's definitely like one of his documentary sort of fly on the wall.
It's more like the editing is more choppy and the camera's more handheld.
Yeah, it's not as much as like Husbands and Wives, which was kind of shot like a documentary.
Right.
This one's kind of a little bit more restrained.
But it's certainly different to Annie Hall though in its. Filmmaking.
Yeah, you do feel like you're not watching a film, you are sort of taking part in their lives.
Yeah, and it also feels like I think that he's far more interested in like shooting it on the hoof rather than setting up any grand... There's no like big grand moments to be captured. And it's funny that even when there is a sequence where they drive to a smelting plant and you see a dead body disposed of in the molten metal, that even that is shot like a throwaway scene. It's not shot like a big set piece.
If David Fincher did that sort of scene now, you'd see the body go into the lava and you'd see it being burnt.
In fact, I feel like he's far more interested in the and I forget which movie he's imitating at the end there, but he's far more interested in the sequence that's shot behind the cinema screen in the revival house that the accused killer,
Mr. House,
runs. I think that's when the camera kind of calms down a bit and he's picking his shots more.
Yeah.
And it's more about that setup, with all the mirrors and the behind the scenes and all the rest of it, which is like ripped off. Like Lady of Shanghai has done that, and like there's a whole bunch of film noirs that have done that. And like the end of it definitely plays like a sort of Double Indemnity type thing. But I forget what movie is screening on the
I think it is Lady from Shanghai that's screening, isn't it?
Is it Lady from Shanghai that's screening?
I think it is, yeah, I think it is.
Yes, it is. Sure. The Lady from Shanghai. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Which, by the way, is also an awesome movie. If people haven't seen Orson Welles' Lady from Shanghai.
I've not watched it yet.
With Mon Oncle for me.
But Mon Oncle. Mon Oncle.
Mon Oncle. And where does this fall on the Mon Oncle scale?
I'd say it's five Mononks.
What? What if it was Manhattan Mononk Mystery? Would you?
Well, maybe then you're going to get the French crowd as well. So maybe you should. Maybe we should think about rebooting it.
The twatty critic would certainly prefer it.
Oh, definitely.
Jacques Tatiz.
I think Manhattan Murder Mystery came at the perfect time because obviously. This was straight after Husbands and Wives, which is also the end of Mia Farrow and Woody Allen's relationship. So it's kind of just, let's go and make a fun movie and just enjoy ourselves while I'm going through this turmoil. And apparently Mia Farrow turned up on set, didn't she, the first day?
Did she?
Have you read that? Yeah, because obviously every part went to Mia Farrow. And I think he said that he was originally going to cast her in the role anyway. And somebody said, "Don't be fucking stupid.
Yeah,
you're going to be, you know, you're breaking up with us." That's why Diane Keaton came in. And I don't think it'd have worked as well anyway with Mia Farrow.
No, she doesn't have Mia Farrow does not have the comedic timing or the gusto. Like from the opening scene. Diane Keaton imbues this role with just verve and excitement, and like you're totally with her, and you laugh at Woody and his inability to kind of get with the program. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, you wouldn't necessarily go as far as she does. You know, you wouldn't break into someone's apartment and start snooping around, but like, you're totally with her.
And it's
funny actually, because obviously Husbands and Wives gets a lot of attention around about this time because of the trials at home, and then obviously Bullets Over Broadway and Mighty Aphrodite are both huge hits after this. So Manhattan Murder Mystery sort of kind of gets forgotten and swallowed, and people don't really talk about it so much. And I don't kind of understand that, because it's, for my money, I'm going to put this on before I put on Bullets Over Broadway, Mighty Aphrodite.
Definitely. I think that is a lot due to Diane Keaton.
And I feel the same way with sort of Midnight in Paris and To Rome with Love, Blue Jasmine, You Will Meet a Tall Dark Stranger, those movies. I'll always put Whatever Works on before those movies. I'll put Whatever Works on before Vicky Cristina Barcelona, to be honest.
Yeah, I watched Whatever Works for the first time, actually, the other week, and I really enjoyed it.
It is good. I liked Magic in the Moonlight. I thought Magic in the Moonlight wasn't bad. The only two I haven't seen is I haven't seen Irrational Man, and I haven't seen Café Society, but Café Society has the worst cast.
Yeah, I know, you wouldn't like that one.
Well, I cannot fucking get to grips with Jesse Eisenberg and... Christian Stewart.
Yeah.
Oh, they just, I can't. I just, I want to, because apparently they're going to be in every film until the fucking day I die. but I can't get with any of it. And Irrational Man, I would like to see it. Because I like Emma Stone, I like Joaquin Phoenix.
Yeah, I've there's still a few I've got to watch. I really enjoyed Anything Else for some reason. It gets such a battering, but I watched it and I really enjoyed it, so...
Yeah, I liked Anything Else. Anything Else has its moments. I think there are... Any time where it's Biggs and Alan, like, talking together, I'm interested.
Yeah, it pops when they're on screen together.
I think that
it's really good.
Yeah,
but I think Christina Ricci's a bit too melodramatic in it.
Well, yeah.
I mean, at a certain point, you are sort of thinking to yourself, you really would have left by now.
Yeah, and I also think that as he gets later in his career, and there's more stunt casting, meaning whoever the flavor of the month is who wants to be in a Woody Allen movie gets to be in a Woody Allen movie. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, oh yeah.
Which is sort of the last 10, 15 years. And it's less successful than the Mia Farrow, Diane Keaton era, because say what you like about Mia Farrow, and she's not...
There's certain Woody Allen films that I really like her in. I think she's great in Hannah and Her Sisters.
Oh, she's amazing in Hannah and Her Sisters. And really great in Crimes and Misdemeanors. But she's not the most versatile of actors in the same way that Diane Keaton is, who's far more versatile. And she doesn't have much energy in the same way that Diane Keaton does. But what it proves with the success of her movies and success of Diane Keaton movies and the failure, in my mind, of something like in Anything Else or like a Melinda or whatever, that have great bits and great scripts but have problematic performances in them, is that Diane Keaton and, first of all, Diane Keaton and Mia Farrow were far better than... I mean, I know a lot of people give Diane Keaton credit, but maybe not a lot of people give Mia Farrow. They're far better than people give them credit for. I mean, Diane Keaton is an exemplary actor and comedian. She really is.
Yeah, comic timing is fantastic.
But then it also shows that you can't just stick anyone in a movie, good script or not, and it work. Like Melinda is immediately made better if there's a different leading actor. It just is. And
yeah, because is it Roddy Mitchell?
Yeah.
She's great in the comedy part.
Right.
She's fucking awful in the serious drama part.
Now it's now
she was shitting a bit.
To be fair, there's some really problematic scripting bits as well, but it's certainly improved by her. Anything else has improved with anyone other than Christina Ricci, and even who's her mother played by?
Oh,
Rizzo from Greece. What's her name? Channing. Stockard Channing.
Channing Tatum.
It's improved by putting Channing Tatum in the role of the mother, clearly. But yeah, no, I mean, going back to Manhattan Murder Mystery and Annie Hall, like, Diane Keaton's, without Diane Keaton's performance in both films, the films don't work as well. They just don't. She is so lovable, and I don't mean that in a, oh, isn't she lovable way. I mean that she, you genuinely fall in love with her. You genuinely are, emotionally empathetic and interested in her as a human being and as a character in both films. And when you add performers like... I mean, Alan Alda is just... I mean, you could watch fucking Alan Alda shit on a phone book.
Yeah, he's so good in this. And I'd like to do Crimes and Misdemeanors and Hannah and Her Sisters at some point.
Yeah, talk about definitely.
But Alan Alda is just, you know, he lights up the screen, and he's not really in it loads in Manhattan Murder Mystery, but when he is, him and Woody Allen, I mean, you look at those two and you think, why are they friends? Because Woody Allen don't really have a good word to say about him, really, otherwise.
No, right.
You know, but that's probably because he sees him as a threat.
But also, I think, probably because that's kind of realistic. We all sort of have those people in our lives that we maybe not hang out with the regularity that they all hang out together. Like, that's maybe the thing I don't understand. But, like, you feel like they've all been friends for a while. And I don't know that he's, like, doesn't have a good word to say about it. I think it's more that he is well aware of Ted's foibles, he's therefore likely to point them out. But I think you're right. I think he also sees him as a threat.
Yeah, I mean, he took over, like, the Tony Roberts role, didn't he, for Manhattan Murder Mystery.
Yeah.
Where, you know, and Alan Alda could have played that role in Annie Hall as well.
He could have done, but I do like Tony Roberts.
He's very good.
I do like him. In fact, we didn't mention him in Annie Hall. We didn't mention so much about Annie Hall. I'm sorry to people who feel shortchanged by it. But, like, I felt like it was more interesting to have a conversation inspired by it than it to go over the movie 100 times.
In Annie Hall, why do they call each other Max?
Right. I love that, though.
I don't know why they do it, but they call each other Max all the time.
Yeah, and yet they're Rob and Alvy, but they both call each other Max. But I love Tony Roberts. Like, I think he's fantastic.
He's perfect in Play It Again, Sam as well.
He's great in Play It Again, Sam. And then he crops up in, is it Hannah and Her Sisters he's in? Yeah.
He's the sperm donor.
Sperm donor.
Yeah. Yeah, because his kids are sitting there and they've got the same haircut as, they've got this huge curly hair. Twin boys by my best friend. And the kids have got two huge afros like Tony Roberts. It's fucking brilliant.
But yeah, I like him as a psychic, but I also like Alan Alda. Like, I wouldn't necessarily want Tony Roberts in Manhattan Murder Mystery any more than I would necessarily want Alan Alda in Annie Hall.
No, what I'm saying is, though, they could both do that sort of role.
Oh,
you could definitely alternate them, but I wouldn't want to swap either of them.
Right.
So, you know, certainly not Alan Alda in Manhattan Murder Mystery.
Right.
So, I mean, do you think he really had sex with what's the girl's name that Mr. House has been boffing? And he says, "Oh, I had to sleep with such and such this afternoon. I've not got another one in me," because he's taking Angelica Houston out.
Oh wait! Oh no! He takes out Helen Moss.
That's it. Yeah, he takes out Helen Moss.
He sleeps with her. Yeah. he sleeps with her. Alan Alda.
Yeah, because you just think Alan Alda probably could.
Oh, Alan, yeah. Even now.
Yeah, yeah. He wears loafers with no socks.
Right. But yeah, no, I mean, the only problem with Manhattan Murder Mystery, I think, is probably the murder mystery bit. The tropes at the end with the constructing the tape and faking that, and then the behind the scene of the cinema screen and all that kind of stuff is, you know, it's cinema 101. You know, you've seen it 100 times before. But I think it's okay because you have like the sequence with Woody Allen and the tape machines when they're trying to fake the phone call. Mm. And he keeps like pressing the wrong one and rewinding the wrong one. And like at one point, like he pulls out the audio cassette and he's trying to like wind up the thing, like that, all that makes it worthwhile, you know?
Well, that's it. I mean, if it was just a straight murder mystery, it wouldn't work because there's so many plot holes with it. Whereas if you stick the comedy, you can sort of go, well, it's funny, so I'll look past it.
Yeah, and it's, I just think it's a nice, it's got a lot to say, or it's got enough to say about a relationship when it's sort of the light side of husbands and wives. Like in husbands and wives, they break up, you know, he cheats on her and she doesn't cheat on him, but she goes off with someone else, right?
Well, he don't cheat on her, really.
Well, he kisses someone.
Yeah, but they'd already broken up.
Oh, have they already broken up at that point?
They've already broken up, yeah.
I'm remembering it wrong then. I watched
it the other week.
That's a husband, that's a marriage that's over, very definitely. And neither of them are willing to fix it. Whereas this
one, you're so happy that the at the end they've got the spark back. It's so good.
And the only thing I don't get is I sort of wish, you know, one of the things I dislike about the later Woody Allen movies, almost the ones post this that he stars in, is that really, apart from To Run With Love, he doesn't really have like an age appropriate leading lady.
I think
in To Rome with Love, he's married to
Judy Davis,
who he's obviously done a lot of stuff with before and who is great. And then, you know, obviously in films like Midnight in Paris and Match Point and things like that, they're all like, they have like a Woody Allen surrogate.
Yeah.
Scoop, he's not romantically linked with Scarlett Johansson, so that's all right.
But you know he would if he could.
Of course. But I just, it would be lovely to see him do like a Diane Keaton movie every 10 years. Like, I just kind of miss it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I was just thinking about it. You know, if they sort of said, if he turned around and says, I'm going to do a Woody Allen, I'm going to do an Annie Hall thing where they meet up again a few years later. Yeah. And just spend the day together. I wouldn't be against it. I'd be like, God, I'd love to see that.
In space.
In space with a cameo by, I'm going to go really off the wall here and say, I'm looking around my room for something to spark something. I can't think of anybody. Say an obscure actor.
An obscure actor?
An obscure actor. Gary Busey.
Udo Kier.
Both of them as twins.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I'd love to see them again on screen together. Absolutely love it. Have you watched his Amazon thing?
I haven't yet. Is it out?
Yeah, it's out now. Yeah, it's his mini series.
Is it?
Yeah, it's out now. I've watched 3 episodes and it's I don't know. It's good. It's all right, but it's missing the leading, because obviously he's starring in it. And it's missing the leading lady aspect. Yeah, if Diane Keaton had been in it, it'd be 10 times better.
Doesn't it have fucking...
It has Miley Cyrus
Miley
in it.
Fucking Cyrus in it.
Yeah. Yeah, but Woody Allen himself in it is really good. It's really good. He does this bit where he's in the barbers at the start and he says, I want my hair like this, because it's set in the 60s and he shows him a picture of James Dean. And he says it, and the barber goes, he goes, so I'm a barber, I'm not a fucking miracle worker. he goes, yeah, but just do my hair like kind of like this. He goes, yeah, well, look what I'm working. He goes out to his wife, and Woody Allen just goes, you can see how I've got my hair? She goes, no, and he goes, James Dean.
Yeah, I mean, I'll give it a watch. Is it set in New York?
It's set in New York, but it's set in the 60s.
Oh, okay.
So, but it's not bad. It's not bad. It's not great, but from what I've watched, it's not too bad.
It is ridiculous, isn't it, that he was able to do Cafe Society, then he's done a TV series. Okay, it's 6 parts, but still, that's like doing 3
it's still
movies.
Like 3-hour movie. 3-hour movie.
Or 2-hour movie, right. It's like doing 2 movies, rather. And then he's even got his 2017 movie done and out. And it has Jim Belushi in it. What the fuck? His 2017, which is just at the moment called Untitled Woody Allen Project, it's described as a period drama set in New York in the 1950s, has Kate Winslet, Justin Timberlake. Oh, for fuck's sake! Why is Timberlake in a fucking Woody Allen movie? And then it has Jim Belushi in it. I'm excited about Belushi. No interest in fucking Timberlake.
He might surprise you.
And Kate Winslet. He might surprise me, but chances are he won't. And I'll hate his face. Anyway, do you have any more to say on Manhattan Murder Mystery?
No, I've not got anything really to say. It's just this perfect Sunday afternoon movie. It's so fun. It's so fun. And, you know, if you're looking for... It has got that Woody Allen relationship, but it's more positive. It's more positive, like, you know, after the Dow. You know, I really do like Husbands and Wives. It's a great film, but it's filled with no positivity about relationships going forward, whereas Manhattan Murder Mystery is sort of saying, yeah, you can get stuck in a routine, but there is fun to be had if you can find out that your neighbour's a mass killer.
Yeah, I mean, I think that you could equally have done Husbands and Wives followed by this as a double bill of, like, one side up, one side down.
Yeah, it's like you could put them together and go, it's like another Melinda and Melinda.
Right, in a way, yeah, it's him playing with drama and comedy all the time. But I would suggest both movies. If you haven't seen them, go see them. If you haven't seen them, chances are you probably haven't sat through this show. But more for you, because it was an awesome show and we had a great conversation and stuff happened. So... Thanks ever so much for being my guest this week, Doc. It was a real pleasure to talk to you. People might be surprised that we didn't talk about things blowing up and kick-ass action like we normally do, but we have levels.
Yes, yes. I'm not all about rocket launchers and hand grenades, you know.
We have different levels. Just the other night, I listened to the World Series and got quite excited. So, you know, levels.
Yeah, why the fuck did John Cusack block you on Twitter?
Don't know. Don't know, mate. John Cusack blocked me on Twitter, which is absolutely baffling because all I've ever said is you're wonderful and here's a movie that I reviewed of yours and it was great. And he blocked me on fucking Twitter. The fuck?
I can't understand it.
I can't understand it either. So it's almost like, I don't want fans. I'm beyond and above fans. I'm going to skulk over here in my Ramones T-shirt and my black cap.
Yeah, and my black gloves, because he wears those a lot in films now, doesn't he?
Fucking all the time. Get out of the black, Cusack. He was good, though, in Shadows and Fog and Bullets Over Broadway. He's a good Woody Allen clone, cipher, whatever you want to call it.
Yeah, the stand-in.
He's better than Kenneth Branagh in Celebrity. Yes. He wasn't bad in Celebrity, but he was also pretty bad.
Yeah, give him a compliment and then immediately take it back.
That's what I'm like, kind of, yeah, you're not bad, you're shit, you're bad, you're awful. All right, sir. Well, look, yes, we'll talk more about John Cusack blocking me, no doubt, on the next show. But for now, all the best, Doc. Thanks so much for being on the show. That's been our Woody Allen review.
Thank you.
Well, back in 2011, I find a movie going to see. A film by Jim and John Movie starring Iggy Pop and me. But when the show was over, I'd nowhere to go. So I'd end up in a bar, sipping my bourbon and feeling low. One night, this wild-looking guy called Frank came over and asked me why I looked so sad as I drank. Told him about my post-movie blues, and then I saw the light in his glass eyes. He told me to go to the after-movie diner. I'm surprised you don't know. There's no place finer. Come on now, let's go. Well, Mr. John Crosswell, he's a man. He's a man with a beard and a man with a plan. Yeah, he is. With Jim and John and Madam Mar, tune in to Fletch Cobbler to start. Guests and reviews, opinions, interviews, comedy and news, Don Dohler and his films, and George Stover at the After Movie Diner. Now it's 5 years old. There's nowhere finer. That's the place to go. Oh, the After Movie Diner. It's where I go. Oh, that After Movie Diner. It's one hell of a show. I'd run a snake with skillet pan and put him in the gym's new hat.